Hello all, and welcome to episode 22 of Enterprise Tech India Unplugged. I'm your host, Deepak. With me, I have Kumaran, who is the chief mentor and the chief technology officer of Tiny Magic. And we've had Kumaran for all this time, and we actually never talked about his passionate subject. So that's what we are going to do and talk about what he really does at Tiny Magic and what Tiny Magic actually does. And I will go maybe listen to his story about how did he come about this whole concept of Tiny Magic and this tiny improvements and tiny improvements in performance, and what does high performance really mean. So welcome, Kumaran.
Hi, Deepak. Nice to be here.
So thank you for agreeing to do this discussion, and I hope I learn. For me, this is a more vested interest for me to learn what Tiny Magic does, and hopefully give you an opportunity to tell us how it really matters to all this technical audience which we have. And we really hope this audience we have is subscribing to our channel on YouTube and Apple Podcasts and Spotify and Podomatic. So we have so many different ways to subscribe. If you just don't know how to do that, just go to our etiunplugged.in/subscribe and you will find out how to do that. So Kumaran, so take us through your journey. How did you start with this concept of Tiny Magic? Where did it all begin?
It began way back, actually. It began probably as soon as I finished college itself. Mm-hmm. For me, I guess it was like during the college times itself, I just wanted to make the world a happier place. Right. And the path that I chose was using technology to make lives better for people and happy and genuinely. Right. So for me, programming was secondary. Probably even towards my third year itself, it was very clear that for whatever I'm doing is for creating joy. Okay. The tool I'm using is technology. It took me 20 years to realize the tools cannot do it. Okay, and I think the nail in the coffin was my 10 years in Microsoft. How it really helped is I was with consulting services, which means that this is the team which helps customers actually use the technology, put it to use. Okay, and when I kind of, in this 10 years, I had a great opportunity to talk to different folks from different parts of the globe, literally. Right. I don't think I have missed any country representation or a point of view on why technology is working or not working there. Thanks to Microsoft. And we used to have something called Tech Ready, where all of them will come. And it was absolutely great where I could really interact and exchange ideas and thoughts. And when I kind of told, was sharing my problems in India. And I used to think like, you know, there's a problem in India because we don't want to spend that much on technology. We are third world countries. We are lagging behind in terms of process, discipline, money, overall, right? Everything. And I think that's the reason why technology is not creating that wow in enterprises. I'm talking specifically enterprises. In consumer space, electronics and technology has created wow, no doubt, right? The biggest example that I do is people sell their kidneys to buy an iPhone. Right. But in enterprises, it's not like that. Every time it's about cutting cost and cutting budget, and year on year, how much will you save? iPhone keeps increasing their thing by 25-30% and people are happily paying for it. Okay. So that is something which really troubled me, right? In enterprises, why aren't we able to give that feeling that technology has made me happy, such that the end customer gives you 25-30% more budget year on year, and it don't have to be a tooth pulling exercise.
Right.
That means there is something clearly missing in the enterprise space, how technology is being delivered. Now, working with Microsoft, I could not complain about lack of technology.
Mm-hmm.
I could not complain about lack of expertise or who I could work with. I could not complain about lack of budget in implementing projects, because right. customers were premium customers who had a big wallet and big money to spend.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And one big advantage of Microsoft is I had huge authority. Customers listened to what I said. Now, having done all these things, the customer is still unhappy.
Right.
That blew my mind. In fact, like one of the first projects in Microsoft, SharePoint, did it very well on time without bugs, everything, all done. Okay. Great, customer gives me a 9.8 rating. All that is good. Some awards also. Few SharePoint implementation first. Everybody is happy. Project well done. Customer is happy. 8 months later, we go for renewal of SharePoint license. A guy says, go get lost. He says, why? You gave me a 9 rating. Then that person says, there's nobody using SharePoint. Why will I renew the license? Okay. Operation success, project success, patient dead.
Right.
He didn't renew SharePoint license. No, forget. Renew the revenue is a byproduct of the failure of the solution. The real thing is the solution failed.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that is like a iceberg hitting a Titanic, right? To me, the solution was implemented, the great Titanic was built, and it is sailed, it set sail. 6 months later, I go, it's sunk. It's there in the ocean. Mm-hmm. An iceberg called non-adoption hit it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So there's something in the bottom of the iceberg which stops adoption. Now, this pained me and my years after year. So this is in the first year, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, year after year, I am trying to solve this problem for 9 years, right? And I started getting deeper and deeper. I realized that there is much more to this than what meets the eye, which is the tip of the iceberg. And technology alone, just looking at technology, technology expertise, better queries, better code, better design alone doesn't solve the problem. Luckily for me, I got exposed to some amount of architecture also. And I generally had interest in mind and psychology, that kind of a thing, even before this stint, right? Then I realized it's, when you look at just technology, you just look at the method bit, but there's hardly anything in the solutions which is addressing the mindset. This is not just the mindset of the solution provider.
Right.
We have to account for the mindsets of the consumers also. Today, the solutions treat them like robots without any feelings.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I realized. Oh, okay. That's what we are missing. So if I take the same SharePoint example, why don't people upload it? Right? There's something which pains them from doing it. Whereas they will go to Facebook every day and WhatsApp every day, check status and upload. There are a bunch of people who will do go every morning and put good morning into 10 WhatsApp groups.
Right.
So we can't say people don't like creating content. Yes, they do like creating content. Good morning to the same group. 50 groups every day morning. Why? Right? No, I can call it stupid. Or I can say it makes sense to some people. Why? I can be curious. So that's another thing which I kind of realized is, as solution providers, we need to develop curiosity, and icebergs hit us pretty much every time. And this is something which I wanted to share and make it as a system and help enterprises adopt it. And this is the genesis of the whole thing. You know, let's deal with these icebergs, discover the bottom of the iceberg. Hence, after an operation is completed successfully, the patient still lives.
Right, right. So tell me a little bit more about how was this journey when you went out of Microsoft? How was the struggle? What was the biggest blocker which you hit when you went outside of a well-paid job? What were the challenges which you faced when trying to create Tiny Magic in the first place?
So from a personal perspective, there was not too much of a challenge because I had already made up my mind that by 45, I won't be working for salary, and I had kind of planned my finances. So on a, and I had actually started that pretty early. By 2002-2003 itself, I had started my planning, I would say. So I quit in 2015. So that's really 12 years of not just planning, I mean, doing stuff to do that, building my corpus, all that was done. So personally, there was not too much of a problem. But from a company perspective, when you come up with something new, the biggest challenge that we faced was, who do we talk to? Do I talk to the business? Do I talk to the L&D? Am I a training company or am I a process change company? What is this, right? We were all over the place. One day I will be talking to somebody who I knew in the business. Next day I'll be talking to somebody in the L&D department. Third day we will be talking to somebody in HR, because we were looking at what we had as a, we called it as a thinking mindset change kind of a thing. Now it kind of fell in no man's land. Okay. The HR is really not, I mean, like they're not, it is there, but for them, they are more towards performance measurement and making things happen. The right. business process guys just want to make things go, look, the scorecard looks green, meet the SLAs targets. The L&D wants specific skills to be generated, and mindset is not a skill.
Right.
So they say, yeah, we want to have a mindset, but then it fell in no man's land because everybody says, yeah, it's important, but nobody really wants to pick it up. Right? Because they can't see a concrete tangible benefit out of it. You know, yeah, it, somewhere it'll be, it's like you know, if you're honest, life will be good to you kind of a thing. If you're kind, life will be good to you, right? But you don't know when, how, what will happen and how much kind you to be, how much honest you have to be. We don't know, right? So it fell into that kind of a thing. Then I realized the, one of the things me and my co-founder Sukumar, we realized that what we are having is an abstract concept. We need to make it more concrete so that people can use it. So it's like creating an instance of, like if I have to take C++, I have an abstract class, I have to make a concrete class out of it, right? And that's not alone, not even making concrete class enough, I have to instantiate it so that somebody can use it. Okay, so then what we did is we realized that the best thing in the current scenario that works is most of the organizations are struggling hard to do digital transformation in their company, either as a consumer or somebody who's providing digital transformation to their end customers. So what we did is we took the HypoHa framework, okay, and we created an instance of that for digital transformation. That means we got more specific about what its applications and use cases will be, what contexts it can be applied. That was a huge change. It took us around 2.5 years to figure out that we have, well, it sounds oxymoronish now, but if you really want people to do something, you have to be concrete about it. And it took us 2.5 years to realize that we were talking this fluff actually.
Okay, so this is, I think this is the first time you mentioned in this conversation HypoHa. So tell me a little bit more about why is it important in the first place? What is it and why is it important? So that is what I'm interested to know, and I'm sure our audience will also appreciate telling us more about it and where can they find more about this information.
Okay. So interestingly, I mean, there is, we can actually go to a site, hypoha.com, which has pretty much all of the work that we have done for the past 6 years. We have filed a patent for it. Probably it'll take another year or year and a half before we get it. So that kind of, we patented it to kind of make sure that it's uniquely identified as a unique item and it's not something which is already there. But all the knowledge under that is actually kind of put under creative license, use it as it is, give credits to us. That's all we ask for. We make money if you want to know how to apply it in your context. But otherwise, if you can read it and use it by yourself, please go ahead and use it. So that's the philosophy of Hyper, right? We do not charge for knowledge, right? We charge for, if you want to apply it in a particular context, for that is where we make our money from. Now, the HIPAA basically stands for High Performance Happily Achieved. Okay. And I think it's kind of given that everybody wants to be happy. And that's your basic goal in life. As Dalai Lama once said, being happy is everybody's goal. The tough question is how.
Right.
Right. Each person has a different way of doing it. From a HIPAA perspective, what I have understood or what we propose is that happiness comes from high performance. And the best way to imagine it is, imagine that you have played a game, right? Mm-hmm. You have played it to your best possible extent, right? You know that you couldn't do that extra 1%. You're completely exhausted, right? You played your best. You lost the game, right? There is a feeling that you have at that point in time. You can call it peace, satisfaction, completeness, whatever. I call that as happiness. The results is really immaterial.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That completeness which gives you that sense of, yes, I am there. Nothing more to do. Nowhere to go. That is what I call as ultimate happiness.
Right. Right.
And just a demystification. Having a coffee, hanging out, going on vacation, looking at a beautiful sight. They are different forms of pleasures is what I would say. They're not bad, but I would use the word pleasure. So when I say delivering happiness, I mean it is reaching that state where you know that you have given your best. And why I'm calling giving it the best is a moving target. So I would say high performance is about giving your best and making sure that you give your best. And you keep on meeting your best on a continuous basis. So when you kind of continuously improve, you are in a high performance mode.
Right.
So if I can lift 5 kgs today, then my goal is to lift 5 kgs and 100 grams because that's the next thing that I can do. Deepak might be doing 20 kgs. Okay. But that's not my goal.
Mm-hmm.
Because what classically that happens is if I'm going to keep Deepak as the goal, it might take me 6 months, it might take me 6 years, it might take me 60 years. Now, then I need to have a lot more energy to keep beating Deepak. So let's say with 6 years, with all the effort, I beat Deepak. What do I do the day after I have beaten Deepak? What do I do then? Now I have to look for some John or Jack who is doing 40 kgs.
Right.
Right. And every time I look at John or Deepak, what am I feeling? Not good. I'm feeling inferior. And when I'm feeling inferior, will I feel happy? I won't. So happiness is not at the end of a journey as you are doing it and have quicker happiness. So if I'm competing with myself and I'm doing 5 kgs and 5.1 kgs is my next goal, I'm looking to beat 5 and reach 5.1. So when I beat that, I have beaten myself only. So I'm not feeling bad. In fact, I feel good that I've beaten myself.
Right. So in your experience, I'm sure you've been doing this quite some time now. So it's been more than 5 years you've been doing this, right? And what has been your experience in terms of the Indian context, in terms of the reception you have got from different enterprises? How has it been so far? Are people getting this concept? Because, you know, most people, most Indian enterprises and IT groups are very cynical in nature, right? So they say, okay, what is this guy going to tell me, which I already don't know, right? Because I have been at the receiving end of such stuff. I'm just curious to know your reaction to where you have been successful, where you've been unsuccessful. What is the general reaction for people to when you explain this concept to them? Do they relate to it or they question it? What is their take on that?
So I think as I was telling last time back, the first 2.5 years was a complete disaster. I mean, we did manage to do business. We need managed mm-hmm. to stay afloat. We were making money. Mm-hmm. But it was a disaster from the concept success and a mindset perspective. Mm-hmm. Right? Whatever happened just happened. Okay. But the real thing I would say is after the 2.5 years, which is past 3.5 years, mm-hmm. there's been a lot good uptake and adoption. And it always mm-hmm. goes through this phase because it's very new. Mm-hmm. The first thing is always a little confusing, right? But then we've got our messaging right that their confidence level is at like 35-40% when they start. Yeah. But the moment a batch is finished, right? The people who have watched the batch finish, that cohort finish, and the participants there, 80-85% of them will stand by us. Mm-hmm. So in simple terms, if I have to say, after we have done it, if they have to stand in a public forum and then say, Hypoha way of doing digital transformation makes sense. It works for us. It is relevant to me. It makes a difference to my life. It has made me and my customers happier. 85% of them will tick that box. Okay, so that's definitely there. So if you look at 80%, 85% of the people would be evangelists. Either they would be fanatic evangelists or general, like let's say, oh, they are good kind of a thing, right? So you have this entire spectrum. But 80% of them will be there, which means that they do see it working and it's more the results that we do. And if you look at DoubleClick inside Hypoha, compared to most of the frameworks that out exist, whether it is process or people or technology development, right? There's a huge emphasis of what we do, what we focus is on doing. Mm-hmm. It's not about knowing.
Right.
So if you go to the Hypoha site, right, hypoha.com, you would actually find a counter there that refreshes pretty much on a daily basis. Okay. And that counter actually says how many times people have practiced what we have done in the real world. Okay. So currently I think we are inching towards, we kind of inching towards 250,000 journals. This is from January 1st, 2016. Right, we are at 245,000 today. So if you look at it, we have an app which checks how much people are doing, what they are doing. So I think that is our key focus. And because the proof is in the pudding, or the proof is in the eating, right? So basically when people do, they actually see the benefits of that. So we kind of focus, I would say 60% of our energies in helping people do it. And in terms of, like, let's say the investments that you look at it, we've literally plunked crores into developing the application, and it's a continuing process, right? And why is it that we were using application is because that helps them do, track and record, and do it compared to, see, typically learning is just I'm consuming, right? So if you look at learning, it is about what content did you do? Did you answer some quiz? This is what I would say 95% of the, or 98% of the learning programs are. Hardly you will find some 2% of learning programs which actually say, tell me what you have applied in real life, mm-hmm. in the context of your life. So there are programs which kind of apply it, but that's treated like a project. Mm-hmm. But for us, it's not like that. So let's say you are working with a customer X. Mm-hmm. I want you to give me proof of having applied me in working with your customer X. If you have a problem applying, come to me. I will tell you how to do it. So it makes difference to where, let's say, the rubber meets the road. So these journals are representations of that.
Is there something, some unique anecdote which you want to share with this audience where you particularly felt happy about somebody who applied Hypoha? I'm not saying from the perspective of just the person who applied it or the organization which applied it, but what you felt after they gained out of it. Is there something which you want to share?
There are many things. I mean, like, we have had hundreds of instances something like this has happened. I'm just thinking of, probably let me take two things, right? One is from a people and an operational perspective, and then maybe I'll give you a hardcore digital transformation technical kind of an example. So the first one was like, it's more operations in HR. There was a person who was close to getting fired. And person was working night shifts and he used to be sleeping in the job. And he was put under performance thing. He was about to be fired. He was serving performance improvement period, PIP as we call it. And the program had started and it was like 1.5 months into the program. One of the senior managers in that person's line decided to try this and we have this bottom of the iceberg metaphor, right? So the tip is the person is lazy, not interested kind of a thing. So when they applied these techniques, they discovered an interesting bottom of the iceberg. The person who was sleeping was actually a new time father. And he and his wife had to take care of the kids. His wife used to work during the daytime. So when he finishes the night shift and goes to home, he takes care of the kid. He doesn't get time to sleep. So he's pretty much exhausted by the end of the day. So when they discovered that the real problem is this, not his attitude. Till then, they were trying to give him skills, give him pep talks on how he should keep himself motivated and things like that, right? So when they discovered that all he lacks is sleep, they actually did a very small change, which is also a part of the fake, which we call as how do you find those trim tabs, which can give you maximum leverage, right? So what they did is that manager, his shift starts at 6 p.m. Shifted that to 8:30. And because he was working on the US, they moved him from East Coast customer to a West Coast customer, a small adjustment. So he'll step into office, go to the dorm, sleep for 2.5 hours. And then wake up and start work at 8:30. So instead of going back home at 5:30 in the morning, he will go at 8, which is okay. It doesn't make any difference, right? Yeah. They can adjust that. Within a month, his productivity went from 80 to 120. And this small thing actually saved the company close to $40,000. That includes hiring, retraining, reference fees, and things like that. Okay. Now, similarly, from a technology perspective, right? When there was a huge process which was which somebody wanted to. So there's an offshore onshore center, and then the offshore team wanted to automate a particular process. They were asking the source or the upstream applications to make some changes. Okay, and they've been asking that for close to 3-4 years, and they just couldn't convince the upstream folks to take this item as priority. So it was just stuck there. Now, and typically one of the things is also about the mindset, right? We do both technology and mindset. It's kind of mindset and method go together.
Right.
So from a technical perspective, the thought is the upstream application should feed data properly for me to do my job well. Otherwise, I'm doing it inefficiently, and that is what it is.
Right.
Now, the framework helped them shift their mindset to say, I am taking responsibility for my output. I'm not going to blame the upstream application. The moment they shifted their mindset, right, they came up with interesting scripting solutions, okay, and things that they could do on their side. They kind of did some very good scripting, some smart ETLs on their side, and they actually got a close to 100K saving in a year with barely 10K investment.
Right.
Okay, so it was, in this case, in the first case, it was about discovering a bottom of the iceberg opportunity. In the second case, also, it was a bottom of the iceberg opportunity. But that only happened when the mindset shifted to responsibility mode from a fault mode. We call it as fault mode and higher responsibility mode. Then we help them identify what place they can actually do that change. So just 10K, they got 100K saving. And something beautiful even more happened after that. When they did this change and they showed that improvement, their credibility went significantly higher.
Right.
Now, in any key strategic decisions, the other team wanted these people to be in their meeting. They started requesting time for them. Because that entire process, which used to take close to 8 hours, was got down to 2 hours by doing this. And when they declare these results, right, this is, you guys changed it without we telling you. You've been telling us for 2 years, we didn't respond to you. Now you did it. Oh, so then you guys must be doing something different and good.
Yes.
So just by doing that, right, these people now got a chair at the table, and actually by letting go and taking responsibility and doing something, they became even more influential. Till then, past 3 years, they have been telling, give me rights. They said, go away.
Yeah.
And when they switched to, I'm taking responsibility, I'm going to do something in my thing. And when they did it, they actually got a lot more power. So I think these two are like pretty powerful bottom of the iceberg opportunities which got converted, and they were truly transformational. One is at an individual level, another is at a team level. One is at an operations and human resources level, and the other one is at process, convincing business and technology context.
So I think this if people who are skeptical about such things, they should give food for thought for them to think about such things and reduce the level of cynicism which always encounters such what you described as intangible. I would describe these as purely tangible improvements which people have seen in their lives. But when you start with them, it really appears to be intangible, and I really hope you get more such anecdotes, and wish you all the best for the years to come, and we'll continue these discussions and maybe one day take more such examples and talk about some of your successes and maybe even failures, who knows, right? So and that is something which I would really love to do next time. So thank you everyone for joining, and please continue to subscribe, and we'd like to hear, and if you have something to talk about, and if you want your concepts or your organizations to be talked about on this show, you're welcome to contact us on Facebook or LinkedIn. And we will be very happy to talk to you. And last time we did that with one of the budding entrepreneurs. And of course, Kumaran is a successful entrepreneur after a long stint in various jobs. And we would really like to help out entrepreneurs in the enterprise tech space in India. Please reach out to us. Thank you and see you next time. Bye.
Thank you. Thanks, Deepak.